Morning, everybody. Welcome. Today's lecture, the effects of exercise on your health through Greenwich Hospital's Community Health. Welcome. My name is Richard Becker. I'm an exercise physiologist for Greenwich Hospital. I work for two different departments within the hospital system. I work for cardiac and pulmonary rehab, which is in the physical medicine department for Center for Healthy Living. And I'm also a certified diabetes educator for the Center for Behavioral Nutritional Health, located at 55 Holly Hill. Today's lecture is being recorded, so if anybody chooses to receive a link for today's lecture, they can always email me. During the lecture, I'll try and put my email up on the screen, but it's richard.becker@greenwichhospital.org. You can email me your email, and I can forward you the link to today's lecture. So you can share the link with family, your friends, or watch something you may have missed. And again, today's, it has been recorded, so it is, everything is anonymous. So if you do send in a question, nobody will know who you are except me. And if you have a question, somewhere on your screen, you'll see a Q&A or a triple star more button. You can click on the chat icon and feel free to send me any questions, or you can raise your hand. It'll prompt me to, during the lecture, to address a question that's relevant to the topic. So I'm happy to have an open forum. Okay. So there's a lot to be said about, exercise and activity and the effects on the health in general and how it relates to our overall health and general well-being and daily activities. In general, the word, exercise has gotten a lot of, press, needless to say, over the past 10, 20 years, different types of exercise, different amounts and quantities. It really has a broad kind of perspective of, having a stereotype of having to go to a gym or a formal setting or, a generic, local fitness center, which sometimes can be very overwhelming and or intimidating and or sometimes unsafe for individuals that may have some special needs or requirements. So my goal today is to kind of put activity together to give somebody kind of a peace of mind of what good it can do, inside the body and outside with our anatomy structure. In general, we have, different types of exercises. We all know that we can determine to have something formal or informal. And in general, I like to, just use the word activity instead of exercise, which can be come across as very formal. When you look at activity and exercise, the general surgeon, the surgeon general's, stand on physical activity for the health has always been around 150 minutes per week, in terms of being active, whether that's, taking a walk, walking the dog, walks in the park around if you're, a Greenwich resident. Maybe something around, the beach, which is very popular. Staying distant in this atmosphere obviously is important, but, outside is a safe environment for people to get out and just move, weather permitting this time of year. Keeping an eye on the colder weather, wind becomes a factor this time of year as well. And obviously ice and slippery, slippery environments where grounds can, thaw and refreeze overnight. So just being mindful of that. So whether it's something formal or informal, we generally look at, trying to get people to get, 150 minutes a week or so, and that doesn't have to be done in a few days, but, over a 5 or 7 day window. So when we also look at, how much exercise we really need for an improvement. And it's really based on a lot of factors. Somebody who is typically a very, very low risk, somebody late in their late teens and maybe even into their mid to, late 30s, even early 40s, if they really don't have a family history of, heart disease or blood pressure or diabetes, generally they're going to be safe enough, in theory, if they have very little or no risk factors for heart disease, to go out and start something on their own with their doctor's permission, especially if they've never done anything before. As somebody gets a little older, maybe into their 40s and older, and they've never done anything formal or have spent 10, 20 years without doing anything, then you start looking at a doctor's suggestion of do you need something, an updated physical, to check for, blood lipid profiles, diabetes checks, blood pressure, maybe an EKG, and even in some instances, an echocardiogram, which can look at the, kind of the structure and flow of the heart if there's a family history of heart disease there somewhere. And in some instances, a formal stress test to see if somebody's heart and body can actually handle, the exertion of a formal activity, which would be able to yield enough to have an improvement. So we'll talk about that in a few minutes. But once you get kind of clearance from your doctor or you get a stress test, the mode of exercise that's practical for yourself, how much, how often, how hard should you do it? So there are four primary factors. So the mode of exercise somebody chooses will sometimes be directly related to the availability. So, does somebody have access to a treadmill, a bicycle, a pool for swimming, a rowing machine, an elliptical machine, an arm crank, a seated cross trainer like a new step? Those things are all great formal levels of activity. Stair climbing, if you look outside, walking in the neighborhood, walking on a beach, hiking through, unstable terrain is always a nice choice for people who like to get out into a more of a woodsy, rural environment where they can, take a hike through, up or down hills or, through different terrains, in a formal hiking environment. Really any of those, in terms of a mode, would be beneficial. How long? It depends on the individual's initial fitness level. Sometimes a 5 or 10 minute walk is enough. Sometimes a 20 or 30 minute walk feels great. Keeping a log of that, as an informal kind of guide to yourself, would be a great move, because if you took a walk around the block for the first time in 10 years, you can time yourself. Say, okay, I felt great when I got back. I was a little fatigued, but I felt okay. And it took you 10 minutes. Mark it down. Next time you may do it in a shorter period of time, maybe 8 or 9 minutes. So you walked a little faster. And that would kind of give you an idea that you're actually improving and your body's getting used to, getting some physical activity. When that happens, one thing you would probably look to add back on is duration. So if your first initial walk was 10 minutes and you got a little better at it and only took you 8 minutes, try and get back to 10 minutes. You may walk a little longer in terms of the distance, you're adding, you're adding that intensity from the speed at which you're walking, which again is going to show, an exercise, benefit from even a 10 or 15 minute walk. But again, exercise is very individualized in terms of trying to prescribe it for everybody, which is why the intensity at which somebody is moving or being active or exercising is important. So, in general, we can use a scale of, let's just say, 1 to 10. It's a generic perceived exertion scale. During an activity at the peak, what you would consider like a steady state, in general, a fairly light to somewhat hard personal exertional evaluation generally is enough to yield a cardiovascular and physical benefit of activity, and also it's kind of a safe environment. Exercise poses risk for anybody, with or without heart disease, with or without physical ailments. There's always a risk associated with exercise, even in the most formal and professional environments. It's not a save your butt kind of statement, but it's generally there is always a risk associated with exercise. It's very small if somebody is previously evaluated, but there is there is always a risk. So if you're doing something on your own, choosing an appropriate intensity is always the first step in creating a safe environment for yourself, starting with that physician's clearance when you decide to get moving. So when you look at the intensity as you're in that peak of exercise, you know, if you're looking at a scale 1 to 10, you know, a 6 or a 7 would put you in that fairly light to somewhat hard level of intensity. And when you're done, how fatigued are you? Do you feel more energetic and great? You want to just go clean the garage and run downstairs and keep doing, you know, active things? Or did you wipe yourself out? You know, did you do too much? And take note of that, because, you know, sometimes, you know, working too hard for too long will give you, you know, negative, you know, diminishing return on the backside of it, because your body spends so much time trying to recover. You know, you kind of wipe yourself out, you know, for the next round or for the rest of the afternoon. So, you know, keeping an eye on that duration and intensity at which somebody's moving. You know, the last one is there's more duration. Frequency. How many days are you doing it? So you look at kind of that 120 minutes or so as a generic, you know, minutes per week. Doesn't have to be. If something is clearly more intense, you know, wouldn't have to do 150 minutes of intense activity. Some people do for training or for hobby or because that's just your level of interest. But in general, you know, 3 to 5 days a week at a minimum, doing something moving, you know, 15, 20 minutes is great. You know, it's better than nothing. And it doesn't always have to be in a row. So if you only have 10 minutes to walk in the morning, go walk 10 minutes in the morning, come back, start your day. And maybe before or after dinner, you have a second 10 minute walk, split it up. That's great. You accumulated 20 minutes of activity that, you know, it will yield benefits for yourself if the intensity was challenging enough for you. You know, picking something, you know, I like to use the word practical, safe, and relevant. You know, if it's an option, you know, if somebody doesn't like, you know, riding a bicycle, I wouldn't put it on your list. If it's something you enjoy, it may motivate you to do it more often. If you're in a setting, and walking on a treadmill is really, really boring, trying something different, looking to a professional to kind of show you a couple of different pieces of exercise equipment, to bring up that heart rate and, you know, create that exertion level for 10, 20, 30 minutes. You know, choose something that you like, or choose something new. Choose something that's challenging enough for you without being over challenging. You know, I would never bring somebody into a rehab or fitness setting and put them on a weight bearing, self moving, you know, exercise piece like an elliptical cross trainer if they just come out of, you know, a heart, you know, heart ailment or a heart condition or a heart procedure, you know, with some extra weight on them and high cholesterol and high blood pressure and new medications. And somebody who hasn't done anything active in 20 years, it would be really inappropriate to put them on something very challenging, like an elliptical cross trainer for their first piece. It wouldn't make sense. And actually, you know, it would be more harmful than good. So somebody like that, you would start them very light, on probably a non-weight bearing piece. Maybe even just some walking through the room, to monitor their heart and their hemodynamic responses to activity, their heart rate, their blood pressure, their EKG. Just to be mindful in a formal rehab setting, that they're exercising in a safe, at a safe level of intensity and duration. So, you know, this all sounds great, and we'll get into the benefits in a second. The last thing I wanted to touch on before we get into the benefits of all of this is, you know, kind of setting a goal. You know, it's easy for me to, you know, sit here and project this on everybody. It's easy for me to sit here and, you know, point in the right direction, you know, do this, do that, do this, and recommend, you know, suggestions for, you know, for your benefit, you know, based on what I think would be, you know, beneficial for you. You know, the individual would really have to have some value to all of this. And that comes from creating a goal. You know, the process of going through a behavior change or any change psychologically goes through 5 stages. And those are pre-contemplation of whatever you're going to be changing, looking at stages of change, pre-contemplation, contemplation, preparation, action for the goal, and then maintenance once you follow through the goal. So pre-contemplation, contemplation, preparation, action, and maintenance. So those are the five stages of change which somebody typically would go through before they go from a couch potato to somebody who's going to move on a regular basis. And sometimes those require goals, you know, short-term goals and long-term goals. And, you know, making the goals specific for yourself are typically the ones that are going to be followed up on more frequently. If somebody says, I'm going to lose 30 pounds this year and I'm going to get back to the gym and every day, you know, going from something to, you know, nothing to that could be a very big jump for somebody. So if somebody backs up a little bit and says, okay, you know, I'm going to start by, you know, by the end of this year as a long-term goal, you know, maybe the goal is to lose 30 pounds, not in 3 months, but maybe in a 12-month period. You know, or looking at their cholesterol levels. I want to drop my cholesterol number below 200 before Christmas, and it's January 12th. So creating a goal that's practical, you know, a longer-term goal, whether it's 1 year or more, or short-term goal, maybe it could be a day, a week, or a month. So he wakes up in the morning and says, you know what, I'm going to walk 10 minutes today. And that's a very specific goal. It's measurable. It's quite often achievable for somebody, which is very important. You don't want to pick something that's a little out of your league, if you will, that's not achievable. It's very unmotivating to create a goal and not succeed at it if it's not practical and achievable or relevant to your overall goal. So I would say start small, work yourself bigger. It's much more motivating. You know, instead of creating these large goals, people are motivated. They work in the short term, but not... you know, typically for the longer term. So think small, like a snowball, and just kind of get bigger and get it into that snowman size snowball. You know, and creating goals that are simple, practical, and achievable, and something measurable. Short and long term. Okay, let's get down to the nitty gritty. And again, if anybody has any questions, I'm just going to kind of keep checking down here. Raise your hand or chat if you have any questions. Let me make sure. Okay. All right. So we look at, you know, benefits of exercise. You know, there's a couple of different types of exercise. You have cardiovascular exercise, which is something that's lighter and longer, you know, 10, 20, 30, 40 minutes up to an hour. That's cardiovascular, getting your heart rate up to a steady state. You have, that's aerobic exercise. Anaerobic exercise is more, you know, higher levels of intensity for shorter periods of time. So if somebody was walking around a track at a high school, that would be more of an aerobic exercise. Something that's aerobic and anaerobic would be somebody who's hiking. Maybe they're hiking on a flat surface and then has to walk up a little hill and then kind of flat off again, and then walk up a couple of rocks and climb a little hill and then again. So those little intervals of higher intensity would be more anaerobic. Higher intensity, higher heart rate, more strength gaining and strength, you know, endurance oriented, and then their heart rate would flatten back out when they hit the peak of that little incline that they went on. That's interval training. That's fine for some if they're conditioned enough to handle that. You know, anaerobic exercise tends to be more for specific conditioning, and that's more of your sprinting, higher level intensity, very short periods of time. So if you look at somebody who's a, you know, literally a sprinter, or you know, something, Olympics, 100-meter dash, anaerobic, high intense, not very practical for most of us. You know, long walks around the block, or a slight little jog for somebody, you know, a mile or so. That's more aerobic, which tends to be the most, you know, typical cardiovascular exercise for most people. Strength training typically ends up being more anaerobic, higher intensity, shorter duration, which is very safe if done properly physically. It also has some physiologic benefits. You know, if somebody takes picks up a 5-pound weight and they can do 10 or 12 repetitions, they feel great and they can do it two or three different sets. Generally, that's an adequate amount of weight for somebody. If somebody picks up 1-pound dumbbells and can curl them 50 times, you're really just kind of overworking the joint. You know, probably better than doing nothing. But if you had the opportunity to go from a 1-pound hand weight at, you know, 30 or 40 repetitions to something, you know, if you have a 3-pound weight and you can do curls or shoulder presses or, you know, any kind of arm movements for, you know, two or three sets of, you know, 8, 10, 12 repetitions where you start to feel that muscle fatigue, that would generally be enough, weight and repetitions to create, you know, muscle strength, muscle endurance for a specific exercise. Stretching is kind of your third component, including, kind of working into balance and falls prevention. We'll get to that. Specific stretching for really any of us is very, very important for a lot of reasons. Blood flow, nutrient flow, relaxation, injury prevention. When you look at individuals who are playing golf and tennis, any kind of athletic, outside environment, even raking, if somebody's more flexible, they're going to be less likely to have an injury or an overusage injury. If they're picking up a box or reaching for something or bending down to pick something up. I've heard more people, pull their back out if they just bend over brushing their teeth over the sink. They get that little torso flexion and, all of a sudden the back kind of seizes up on them. And that typically comes from an inflexibility in the, in the spinal torso area and in the hip area. That's kind of a common thing that, could have been prevented by just even a little bit of flexibility or stretching exercises. So, those things all kind of come together and help, in terms of the types of activity that will cause a positive effect in the body. Getting down, oops, I have a question here. I'm going to just pop on a little bit. Okay, I had a question come in. The individual has COPD. Would I recommend HIIT training for them? HIIT training is a high intensity training method. There are different types of HIIT training. If somebody has COPD, it depends on a lot of factors. When you look at HIIT training or a high intense level of activity, first of all, practicality, age, initial fitness level, the severity of disease. So there's a couple of factors in there, which could be a little bit longer of an answer without a little bit more specific. So let me see. Okay, if that individual doesn't mind, they can email me some more specifics in terms of answering that question. I'd be happy even to take a phone call or quick little Zoom or something to give a reasonable answer to that, a little bit more specific to somebody with COPD and high intensity training. If somebody, as I've been an asthmatic my whole life, generally since about 6, 7, 8 years old. I played lacrosse all through high school and college. I've done some high intensity training myself. COPD or asthma is not really a COPD. It's in the criteria of COPD, but depending on the severity of somebody's pulmonary disease, would depend on again all those other factors. But certainly, if somebody has a controlled COPD, controlled asthma, and they have a fitness level, conducive for higher levels of exercise, it might be a safe environment for them to exercise in, but it may not also be the only thing that would help benefit that person and help control the COPD portion of their lifestyle. So if that person would like to email me, you're feel free to do so, and I'll repeat that again: richard.becker@greenwichhospital.org. Okay, so moving on. So when you look at the general effects of exercise, we look at heart improvements. So you look at heart efficiency. The heart is a muscle. The heart can get actually literally physically stronger with proper amounts of exercise. So you can get a stronger, more efficient heartbeat, if you will. The general chain of events that happens is when we inhale, we take in air. In that air, we have oxygen. Eventually, that oxygen ultimately, in the ideal situation, barring any outside, barriers, in terms of illness, that oxygen molecule gets, down into the lungs, gets into the bloodstream, gets sent to the heart. The heart pumps it out to the body. The heart will pump it out and the body will kind of receive it as it needs to. The heart you can consider as a fuel. The oxygen will be considered a fuel. The heart and the body will pump it out to where it needs to be, when it needs to be there. And that oxygen molecule will be used as part of the energy source required to perform the activity that's needed at the end of that kind of runway. So once that oxygen molecule is used and broken down, carbon dioxide is a byproduct of activity or metabolic activity. That molecule of CO2 gets pumped back into the veins, which will bring all that used blood, if you will, back to the heart. Heart will pump that all of that back to the lungs, and exhale, we exhale carbon dioxide. So we're bringing in oxygen and getting out carbon dioxide. So one thing that formal exercise will do is improve the efficiency of getting in that oxygen, getting it to where it needs to be, using it when it gets there, and getting out that carbon dioxide. That is our what you consider your cardiovascular fitness, your aerobic capacity. And the more efficient your body can do that, the more conditioned somebody generally is. As a result of that, your heart no longer has to work as hard. So sometimes your resting heart rate and your exercising heart rate, resting blood pressure, resting blood pressure, exercising blood pressure will all kind of drop a little bit. Heart rate and blood pressure will always go up during exercise. If it's an appropriate amount and volume and duration of exercise, it'll come up a fair amount, depending on medications and fitness levels and, a few other factors. And in the end, if your blood pressure and heart rate come down generally fast, if you will, faster heart rate and blood pressure come back down generally is indicative of somebody who's more fit. So that's a good sign that somebody has some conditioning level on the inside of the body. Their heart rate and blood pressure levels come down more rapidly than somebody who may take 5 or 10 or 15 minutes to kind of cool down. Somebody who cools down and gets their heart rate down quickly is generally somebody who's going to be a little bit more conditioned. Pulmonary kind of goes along the same way, in terms of the pulmonary respiratory benefit of activity. So the heart and the lungs work together, getting that oxygen out to the body and getting the carbon dioxide out of the body. In terms of getting air in, getting carbon dioxide out, there is some pulmonary respiratory benefit to continuous exercise as well. Both strength in some regards and also cardiovascular as well. Diabetes. As a diabetes educator, I always recommend activity for most or all diabetics if it's relevant and conducive to their health and their lifestyle. One thing I do always encourage is obviously clearing with their physicians, but sometimes if somebody is using exercise as part of their plan for diabetes management and or weight loss, my big goal as a counselor is always to look at activity and exercise in the big spectrum, not just a moment in time. For instance, if somebody is going to go for a 30-minute walk and they burn, 150 calories, I want them to think of more than just the 150 calories in the 30 minutes and maybe the sugars that they burned and the blood sugar changes that occur before and after. In general, for somebody who has diabetes, yes, you're going to burn more calories. Yes, you're going to burn more sugar down with some activity, whether somebody's controlling their weight or their diabetes. But in the bigger picture, you're conditioning your metabolism to just run a little bit more efficiently. So if somebody's burning 150 calories over a half an hour, it's great. You may burn another 50 or 60 or 70 extra calories in recovery, which is still your energy still kind of churning, your body temperature is coming down, hormones are being replenished. So if you think of driving your car, you put it in your garage, it's going to stay hot for an hour before it actually cools back down. So that heat is kind of free energy coming off the vehicle. So if somebody does an adequate amount of activity for 20 minutes or half an hour, there's still a lag afterwards where the body is still kind of churning, trying to recover. And they call that actually EPOC, is excess post oxygen consumption, where somebody is really burning calories and metabolic activity is improving. Most specifically to a diabetic, insulin that your body is making on its own will tend to work a little bit better. So exercise has been shown to increase insulin sensitivity or decrease insulin resistance. I know it's a little kind of funky, but basically exercise helps you, your insulin in your body work better, which then will help lower your blood sugar on the back end, along with burning extra sugars because you're burning more calories during a level of activity that you may have not done, sitting on the couch, not being active at that moment. Activity, looking at muscle memory, when you look at exercise, you know, if we stay sedentary, generally because of age and duration of life, just because somebody's, 60 or 70 doesn't mean their metabolism is dropping and they're more sedentary just because they're 60 or 70 years old. In general, over time, most people become less active, over a lifespan. It's more of a progression of duration rather than just a specific age. Like, oh, you're 70 or you're 60, your metabolism is down it's a cumulative thing that we want to try and stay away from. So keeping up our metabolism and our general health as we age, as time goes on, is very important because it's tough to get back on the back end. But one thing as we do age is creating and keeping up muscle memory. That doesn't mean if we were running and playing ballistic activities like soccer in our 20s, doesn't mean we have to do it in our 60s or 70s. But levels of activities to keep our bodies moving, our arms moving, our legs moving, over time will help everything we discussed prior, metabolism, heart rate, blood pressure, reducing risks for heart disease development, and also doing things around the house, whether it's vacuuming, cleaning the garage, carrying groceries, carrying, laundry baskets, playing golf, playing tennis, sometimes playing a sport is not always enough conditioning for life. I took a tennis teaching class in college, and I remember the professor who taught the class, always said, you don't play tennis to keep in shape, you keep in shape to play tennis. I just thought that was a very interesting, sometimes obvious statement, but as a physical education student, it meant a lot to me, and I remember it, him saying that, you can do tennis casually and as an activity, and I think it's great. I'm not saying you have to, condition before you play tennis, but he was passionate about tennis, and so if you want to play tennis, at a competitive level, it was interesting to hear him say, moving before you play tennis will make both ends a little bit healthier. I thought that was always an interesting, comment by him. I won't tell you how long ago, but it was far enough back. it's just something to think about. Where if somebody is playing tennis and you think that's enough, sometimes a little extra on the back end of it may make your tennis or your golf or whatever your hobbies are maybe a little bit more helpful for the sport itself, or put you at less risk of an injury, creating this muscle movement and flexibility. I've seen more golfers and tennis players over the past 10 or 15 years turn to really serious, kind of functional training and specific stretching exercises to improve their golf games, sometimes caused by a little bit of an injury. We've all heard the term of, tennis elbow and golf elbow and, all these other, ailments that come with repetitive motion. The one thing I can say even for myself is, if somebody has a repetitive motion over a period of time, could it have been prevented with proper amounts of flexibility? I've seen more golf elbows and tennis elbows fixed because of a locked up shoulder or locked up hips, where ranges of motion and rotation that you need for a tennis serve and a golf swing, if a part of that kinetic chain is off even a little bit, hips, thoracic spine, shoulders, the pressure that's being diverted will typically go down the food chain and end up at a at a source, you know, closer to the element in terms of a golf club or a tennis racket, and quite often the elbow takes takes a beating. So yes, you may have elbow inflammation or bursitis or tendonitis, but what was it caused by? You can treat the overusage injury, but let's look backwards and see, you know, where somebody was probably either weak and or inflexible, you know, back on the food chain a little bit. You know, do we look at the shoulder, you know, the body, the torso, the hips, the legs, the, you know, the pelvic region, to see where kind of the limits were. Let's see. We have a question here. Let me see what we got. One sec. Okay. Question was a great question for diabetics. If somebody's diabetic and is or wants to exercise, should they check their sugars before and after exercise? Again, a little bit more specific, feel free to email me for more specifics on your specific situation. But in general, a couple of factors. Depends if somebody is type 1 or type 2 diabetic. It'll also depend if somebody has eaten, what kind of medication they're on. It'll also depend on, how new of a diabetic they are and how new of exercise they are. And I'll give you an example. In cardiac rehab, we require any diabetic, at least in the beginning, to check their sugars. We do it before and after exercise. There are certain parameters that we would follow based on that individual. If they're type 1 versus type 2, did they take insulin? Are they on short-term or long-term insulin? Sometimes they have their own meter. They have these continuous glucose meters. We can check it the whole time they're there. We'll also check it with our machine to make sure they kind of match up at the hospital. But in general, I mean, if somebody really is new and they're, let's just say, a generic type 2 exerciser, a generic type 2 diabetic, they've had breakfast, they want to go for a walk at noon, they're on no medications that would put them at a hypoglycemic risk. Let's just say we'll take a 60-year-old type 2 diabetic woman who's on a drug like metformin, which is a drug to help your blood sugars, prevent your blood sugars from going up. It doesn't really put you at risk for hypoglycemia. You know, if somebody's new, certainly you can check it before and maybe after. interestingly enough, sometimes because of the stimulation inside the body and the endorphin effect and the cortisol rise you get with activity, it's not uncommon that we see an increase in blood sugar after exercise, depending on where they're starting. If somebody comes into an exercise rehab session at the hospital and their blood sugars are 200, like, wow, it's kind of high. It's like, well, I just had breakfast and, you know, I had two pieces of whole grain toast with some almond butter on it. I was 120 when I woke up this morning. Now I'm 200. That's could be a peak blood sugar. And hey, you know what? That's fine. That's kind of what you would expect an hour or so afterwards. Where are they two and a half hours after that breakfast? So if they started at 120, came in, they're 200. And an hour later, then now, which is now 2 hours after breakfast, and exercise, they're probably gonna be back down to 120 to 150-ish. So their body's gonna recover and pull it down on its own with the addition of some of the calories and sugars burned during the activity. You'd probably see a return there. On the other hand, sometimes if somebody comes in and they're 110, 120, and they maybe haven't eaten, and the exercise is new and it's stimulating for them, and if they start to drop a little bit, the body's defense mechanism is to tell the liver to secrete more blood sugar because it sees it as being a little too low. So if somebody comes in at 110 or 120 and they leave and they're 130, 140, like, oh my God, what happened? Why did it go up? So that's the old cortisol liver's job to kind of keep us above our Mendoza line. What you will see generally is an hour later, a drop on the back end. If somebody hasn't or isn't going to eat, you would see a drop on the back end during that recovery epoch stage. In general, if somebody's new, before and after, an activity for a diabetic would be, you know, to start in a, you know, a generic appropriate, but there are some more factors in there. So if that listener wants to email me, richard.becker@greenwichhospital.org, you know, feel free to do so. I want to just see, I want to try just for a second and see if I can put my email up on the screen so I don't have to keep telling you all. How about that? I figured it out. Al's going to be so proud of me. Okay, moving on. So we have a couple other things. We, to kind of end with a few things before we can, you know, start taking some more questions is, you know, immune responses. You know, our body physiologically will always, in general, work better when it's had a chance to move. And, you know, regenerate, you know, cells in our body, and our immune system has a chance to, improve and move, nutrients, blood flow, the oxygen delivery mechanism in our body. I really can't see anything in our body that doesn't improve with regular activity, done in appropriate amounts. When we look at, how does our immune system respond, or how does our cortisol respond? Sleep is very important. Sometimes individuals who don't sleep well, quite often go to bed sometime with some level of anxiety. And that's not always a bad thing. We always have things on our mind, in this day and age, we're dealing with the pandemic, we're dealing with, children, grandchildren, spouses, finances, TV, we always have things that are kind of on our mind. And if somebody has a personality where, they spend, a lot of energy that they may have not had to on something, and it's kind of rearing on them, and they go to bed and they're, at night, and they're still thinking on it because they just have this level of energy inside them that they're just kind of built up a little bit. Sometimes a quick walk or a quick, exercise in general, some level of activity, gives some release to that, so they have some outlet, and their body will yawn. You'll find quite often that people will sleep a little bit better when they bring activity into their lifestyle. Now, having said that, when I exercise, I try to do it earlier in the day. Some people have no choice. I do not sleep well. If I do activity later at night, I kind of get a little bit wound up. So if I am going to do something more formal, I try and do it earlier in the day. So it kind of, I don't want to say wears down before bedtime, but I certainly sleep better when I exercise early in the day, as opposed to, getting towards bedtime. That's particularly for me. Some people can work out till 9 o'clock at night, come home, have a little bite to eat, get in bed at 10 and say goodnight. That's great. It's all personal, but for me, I tend to do it earlier in the day. So I suggest what time of day is the best, whichever time is the most practical for you, and fits into your schedule. That may change during the week, may change on the weekend. But I tell people, what's the best time for weight loss? Whatever fits into your schedule. I think psychologically is probably the most efficient answer for that. Okay, another question. I'm going to pop off here. Okay, the question was, can I talk more about exercises for 75 and 85 year olds? Absolutely. If somebody is in their 70s and 80s, quite often moving around the house is pretty much a start. Even going into a doorway and holding onto a doorway, the door jams, and just starting with some simple leg raises, some knee raises, some knee marching, even doing that for, 10 or 20 times, walking around your house once, coming back, marching again for 10 or 20 marches, is just something to get the body moving again. Taking a broom handle, or some kind of a, some kind of a stick, reaching it forward, reaching it up over your head, taking it and rotating it across the front of your body. Being creative, I'm just throwing out some very, informal, simple things that somebody may have around the house. Grabbing a couple of soup cans, 1 or 2 pound soup cans, doing some arm curls. This is all assuming that somebody doesn't have a specific orthopedic limitation and their back is fine and they can walk safely without a risk of falling. And, they're not using a walker. If they need it, use it if they're walking around the house. Posture is always really big. Sometimes just sitting in a chair and slouch forward is just very comfortable. All of a sudden you sit up and it's an exercise because indirectly you're stretching a lot of the body when you go from slouching up to sitting. And just doing something like this multiple times during the day is exercise enough for somebody just to get the body moving. If somebody had a safe environment where they had stairs, you can hold onto the railings on each side of the stairs. You can take your feet from the floor, step one up at a time, and just tap the top step. It's kind of a smaller coordination movement. That somebody can do around the house, once a day, all day, anytime you go through a door jam, just stop and march 10 times, get your legs moving. So that's generic, things that I can suggest that people could do around the house between, doorways, marching, walking, just stair stepping, just tapping your feet on the stairs. Also looking at, like I said, a broom handle, a stick and some soup can movements, punching, if somebody had the access to an old stretchy band or a TheraBand or a tube, tube pulls, tube bands, really anywhere you can move your arms or your legs, standing or sitting from a chair. If you're sitting in a chair, taking your leg and kicking your foot out, bending your knee, extending that foot in and out is always a very simple, generally safe exercise to start with. Somebody's laying in bed, a straight leg raise. Laying in bed would work the leg muscles a little bit. You'd be surprised how quickly some of these little things can add up. If somebody was going into more of a formal environment, that would be even more detailed. We probably have somebody, some kind of a physician's clearance in a professional environment. So we can figure out your level of activity, your level of health, walking and body movement, biking, exercise biking, it's always your general, starting points, arm cranking. simple things to get somebody just moving again. So when, those suggestions change on age, I'm just kind of throwing something out there for somebody who had a question about a 75 or 85 year old. But again, now that I have my email up here, if you have more specific questions, I'm happy to follow up on an email. Once the lecture is over today. Okay, we got one more question up here. Okay, walking outdoors during the quarantine for muscle. Let's see here. For muscle tone. I'm assuming they're talking about muscle strength, leg strength. So if somebody's walking, the hills are going to be a little bit more challenging on the muscles because of the level of intensity. Your pace will clearly slow down. Not that you have to look at, look for hills, but when somebody walks up a hill or down a hill, it's actually harder to walk down a hill than it is to walk flat. Clearly, it's harder to walk up a hill than it is to walk flat, but that'll tend to work more into your leg muscles. If somebody's looking for something more specific to get their muscles, their leg muscles moving more, which is generally the muscle group associated to walking, obviously, sit to stands out of a chair, those chair leg extensions, straight leg extensions with the straight leg, sitting in a chair, leaned back, or laying in bed or laying on the floor, if that's safe to get up and down off the floor for yourself. Sometimes something a little bit more specific, like a squat. So if somebody's holding onto something secure, like a sink bin, or a sturdy stair rail. If you're holding on, bending down into a squat, pretending you're sitting into a chair. If somebody Googled, just a sink squat, you would see, the proper form on that. But, ideally your backside would stick out behind you. Your chest would come over your thigh muscles, your quads, and your hips would sit back in a chair. You don't have to go all the way down to the ground. Save your knees. You can come down a couple of degrees, about halfway down, and stand right back up. And you'll find a couple of those are going to be very effective. Similar to sitting in and out of a chair. When you sit up out of a chair, that's not too low. You're leaning forward, you're standing up. And then safely, if you have something to hold on to, great. Or if you want to hold on to the sides of the chair for safety, sticking your hips down slowly back behind you and, doing that 3 or 4 times in a row, sometimes is a lot for someone, but, again, keeping track of that is something that, that would be part of that goal setting, that we discussed earlier. Really the one thing, if that is in specifics to the question, and the question about how about getting outdoors to walk for muscle tone because of quarantine, any additional walking that somebody, gets out and does, flat or incline or decline, because, Connecticut, we got a lot of hills. We're not Florida. So we have, there are hills in Florida, but for the most part, we can't go anywhere in Connecticut without walking up or down somewhere. And if you've ever stepped on Greenwich Avenue, you'd be aware that by the time you get to the bottom and you're going to walk back up, it's much harder. So people tend to start at the bottom and work their way up, so they get to go downhill on the way home. Any other questions? I think I've touched on everything I've wanted to today. Just looking at my list here. I'll wait a second. And while we're waiting, if anybody else has any other questions, again, my today's session is recorded. So my email is here. Feel free to email me. I can send you a link as soon as our Sevi media guy behind the scenes sends it to me. I will send it out to anybody. I'd like to thank all the crew over at Greenwich Hospital's Community Health Department that put this together today. I appreciate you having me on, and everybody who was, savvy enough and to throw a question out there. I know we're all kind of used to Zoom now, but it was great to have some questions. The COPD question, the diabetes question, and the question about the 75 and 85 year old exercise, feel free to email me again. Happy to have a chat and an email discussion or whatever we need. The last thing I will say is, working with two different departments, cardiac rehab and pulmonary rehab are covered services for private insurance companies, depending on how recent a cardiac event was and how recent any pulmonary event was. There is some potential for exercise coverage for a 3-month window as a part of rehab. It works kind of like physical therapy if somebody has had a recent event. Likewise, private insurance companies, Medicaid and Medicare, cover diabetes education services through the hospital. And for any information on those services, you can also email me as well. And we can look at, lab numbers and lab values and health history to see if you do qualify for those services, which would cover a lot of specific, questions and criteria for somebody who suffers from any of those. Okay, I think that's it I have for today. No more questions. I'd like to thank everybody today. Thank my friend Al behind the scenes and the crew over at Greenwich Community Health. And hope everybody has a great, safe day. And if you're out there and you're on the list coming up, watch out for those emails to get on your list for your vaccines. I hope you all have read enough about it and are encouraging yourselves and family members to let's squash this thing and, crush COVID and let's get back to our regularly scheduled lives, as they say, right? All right, everybody, have a great day, great afternoon. Stay safe and healthy, and I'll see you online soon, maybe. Have a great day, everybody. Bye now.